December 14th, 2015. And with that, we call the meeting to order. If somebody would like to read the approval of the agenda.
I move that the agenda, the revised agenda of Monday, December 14th, 2015, Board of Directors meeting be approved as set forth, and that each item is considered ready for discussion and or action.
Is there a second?
Second.
And this is a roll call.
Director Jansen.
Approved.
Director Westerkamp.
Aye.
Director Humbles.
Aye.
Director Jacobo.
Aye.
Director Meisterlein.
Aye.
Director Anhalt.
Aye.
President Laverty.
Aye.
All right, we'll move right into Dr. Buck and your comments tonight.
Great, thank you. So I want to thank everyone who attended the State of the District program last week. It was on Friday. I want to be sure to thank the students who shared information from their schools as part of the displays. We had students from Johnson Steam Academy, Iowa Big, Metro High School, and the district's Special Services Department. Thank you also to the student performers from Hoover Elementary and Jefferson High School. Both of those choral groups were outstanding, and you kind of get, if you had a chance to be a part of it, you kind of get goosebumps just saying it even now. I've had a number of community members both email me and talk to me in person about it, and I would say the overwhelming, very positive, and the overwhelming highlight is the amount of student inclusion in that activity. So very well received and really nice event. The program included several videos. We want to share one of those tonight. Everyone enjoyed having a group of experts explain our construction and maintenance budgets.
We have two important funding sources to tell you about.
Both of these are really great and they make our schools better.
Thanks to the School Infrastructure Local Option Tax, known as SILO, many schools have new heating and cooling systems, new technology, new windows, and lots of new stuff.
It's kind of like making a brand new school.
SILO is now known as SAVE, Secure and Advanced Vision for Education.
Why?
I don't know why, but it sure benefits our school.
The district physical plant and equipment levy. Pebble support maintenance and upkeep.
Did you know that there are 425 acres of grounds and 2.7 million square feet of building space?
This place is huge!
Every year, Pebble funds are used for building maintenance and repair.
Roof and brick work.
Campus parking lots and playgrounds.
Recess is great!
The facilities master plan.
We follow a schedule. We have a project this year and a project next year. Make sense?
Projects that keep everyone in our schools safe and secure.
That means me and you and you.
Providing school buses.
I love my bus driver, Bob.
Energy conservation efforts.
We are green.
Pebble has been supported for 40 years.
And we thank you.
So they said it well. Thank you to our community. We also want to take an opportunity to publicly thank Shive Hattery for sponsoring a full-page ad in the Gazette earlier this month, and thank you for the support. One of the other things that was underway all of last week, actually, were some school equity efforts, and they were spotlighted last week in our Equity Summit meetings. Throughout the week, building leaders shared their school's equity goal and the ways they communicate and monitor that goal. In addition, they discussed instructional tools and strategies in process to address equity. Though the collaborative process, schools had the opportunity to learn more about what approaches, strategies, and protocols others are using. I had the good fortune of sitting in at the Van Buren, Hoover, and Hiawatha presentations, and I would tell you they were well received by all those that were there and really powerful learning opportunities about the equity work that's going on in our classrooms. It really was a great summit, and my understanding is we'll do another round of those in June. I think that's what we're planning on. So this is already public news, but I've not had the opportunity to share it here, so I want to formally announce the scheduled opening of our second magnet school. The Kenwood Leadership Academy Magnet School will open the start of 2016-17 school year. The magnet school will focus on leadership development through the Leader in Me program, and that can be found at theleaderinme.org, and will infuse the principles of leadership throughout the school and curriculum, aligning with the Iowa core standards. So we're excited about this opportunity for our students and adults that serve them. And we are in the process of inviting input from parents, staff, and community regarding a draft of the 2016-2017 district calendar. So the draft is posted on our website along with contact information, and community members can provide input through January 3rd. So lots going on.
Very good. And Steve, I think that that video should be used for all of our new board member training. It condensed it down to like 2 minutes. It took me 9 years to figure that out. They did it in 2 minutes. So I don't know what's been going on, but it was, you know, take it how you want. But anyway, are there any board reports tonight or comments? Gary?
I have several. We must be approaching a new legislative year, because there are lots of things on in that area. Iowa School Board Association is sponsoring a advocacy workshop tomorrow at Grantwood AEA that I will be attending. I think, I don't know if Dr. Buck.
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
Yep.
To start, help us kick off the state legislative. So I will report back with what I hear and what we hear with that. New acronym, ESSA. Unbelievable, after 8 years of work and discussion, we finally have a new reauthorization of the Elementary Secondary Education Act. Now will be known as Every Student Succeeds Act. It was passed by the U.S. Senate and the House last week, and promptly signed by the President. So it is law. A lot of people, a lot of questions, a lot of further information to come out. We do know that there will. We have not given up the yearly testing. Will still go on, but. AYP, annual yearly progress, will be measured. Some of the biggest things that we do know is the direction and the focus will return to the state control and local boards. So as we move forward, the good news, the bad news is it may mean, probably will mean more diligence and work for us as a local board. One of the questions is asked, will there be more money? The appropriations, the authorization does have more money in it, but as government works, that doesn't mean that the appropriations will be there. No Child Left Behind was authorized at a much higher level than was appropriated for it. So we will see what happens in the coming months, whether or not there actually is more money that we'll actually see. One of the things that will be vital will be actually the rules interpretation. So we have the law, but it's it always comes down to then how the rules are written to work with that law. There is hope that many of the rules will be adopted as early as April. And if it doesn't come in April, then it could be pushed back as late as December of next year. So what I'm hearing from the National School Board Association is there probably will be a lot of active pushing and dialogue and so on to get those rules written as quickly as we can. So I think that it's a real positive. It was a compromise. It was a bipartisan compromise. So like all compromises, not everybody is probably totally happy, but I think we have something better than what we're currently using. What I've told people is the sad part is we've lost a generation of students that were, I believe for us, we're stumbling under No Child Left Behind. We have teachers that have not operated under a system that did not know No Child, other than No Child Left Behind, and administrators, and probably superintendents. I think we need to clear the plate a little bit, look at, just because we've done things, that's the way we've done things. As we move forward, it doesn't have to be the way we do things in the future, so. Good news. Working on our listening posts. We have one set up for, well, I'll let John talk about something in January possibly, working with the city PTA, hopefully in February or March, and then the Cedar Rapids Education Association later into the spring. But all good things.
Thank you, Gary. Anybody else? Any other board reports, comments? Yeah? No? Yes.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Rafael.
I have one. So just really briefly, I had an
extremely awesome opportunity to participate in Educator for a Day. So this was back in November. I believe it was at the same time that the convention was going on. Had an opportunity to work with some kids at Hoover Elementary, specifically within the ELL program. So with those kids, stepped into the shoes of staff members and teachers that work with kids of all sorts of diverse backgrounds with all sorts of languages. With that, like I said, it was extremely positive, and there were other community members that were invited to participate, and all I heard was just very good positive feedback on having been invited and having been able to participate. There were news media people that were there, as well as elected officials. So I look forward to, you know, even to the next year when other opportunities or events like that come up, you know, us having the opportunity to potentially go in there and lead a class for a day or half day.
Great, thank you. Any other board reports? All right, so just, again, just a little bit of a teaser. So the district has been working diligently with some of the community organizations around equity and diversity issues, poverty issues, violence in our community. There are many different organizations working on some of these issues, and the district's been actively involved and will continue to be actively involved with a lot of those. But on Tuesday, January 12th at the African American Museum in Cedar Rapids, we will have an event, more details to come, but it will be a showcase and a listening post for our community to talk about some of these issues related to our school district and our community. So be on the lookout for that. We'll be getting more out in the media and through those channels as well. And a few more details. We'll actually have a school board meeting the evening of Monday, January 11th. So we'll get out some specific ideas and plans that we plan to further look into on January 12th. So again, board members, that's kind of new information that just came together today. And thank you, Nancy, for reaching out to them for us on that. So. Without any further ado, we'll go ahead and move on to communications, delegations, and petitions. And Chris Tompkins from Alliant Energy, if you'd like to come forward. I have you first on the agenda here.
I just wanted to take a minute and stop in tonight and congratulate the district on their continued efforts in terms of energy efficiency as you work through your PEPL plans and your master energy efficiency plan. And with the Hiawatha remodel and the Washington project that just finished up here this fall, happy to present a check for just shy of $500,000 to the district.
Glad to accept that. I had a formal picture before the program, so thanks again to Alliant for all the work that you do and cooperation. Well, you want to have that in safekeeping?
Yeah.
Just, I don't know if we can pass that one.
No.
And then next we have Lawrence Winklowski. So Lawrence, if you could approach the podium and just state your name and address, and just keep in mind that we have 5 minutes for public comments.
Sure, Lawrence Winklowski, 4234 Moreau Road.
So several weeks ago, I had no desire to speak about the calendar, despite having a few reservations. My biggest reservation continues to be the makeup of the calendar committee. I think it is insane that we need a committee of 17 people to figure out the calendar. While I have a great deal of respect for the two parent representatives, as they both work extremely hard to improve our district, I think it is wrong that the two parent representatives are the city and state PTA presidents. And this statement is coming from an officer of a local PTA. While a small percentage of parents are PTA members, at Kennedy is less than 100. Some schools in our district are not even represented by the PTA. There is a 10-to-1 ratio of students to teaching staff in our district, while the parent representation on this committee is only 11%. Who represents the single parents, parents who are unskilled workers, parents with limited vacation time, or parents whose employer is not willing to be flexible with the calendar? Then there are those families who just don't have a great support base within our community. The proposed calendar that came out last week was missing some supporting detail required to make a decision on whether the calendar would work for one's family. What will be the bus schedule for Wednesdays? How will we support the families whose children are too close to bus and too far to walk? Then there is the all-important question, where's the money for the child care coming from? And is this money better used to hire more teachers? In previous years, I've been told that we could not have late starts since this would create an attendance problem with middle and high school students. So what's changed? I do not need to be lectured or patronized on why teachers need the time for the learning communities. I get it. But every aspect of this calendar is about what is most beneficial to the teachers, and by the omission of the announcement, this calendar was developed so professional learning time is optimal. However, this optimal calendar will most likely hurt the earning ability of some families in our district. I saw the theme of Dr. Buck's state of the district address of relationship matters most. I'll be honest, I haven't watched it yet, but when I saw it, the title, what came to me first was communications and transparency. These are the basics for good relationships. When it comes to communications and transparency with the calendar, the best place to find this is not from the district, but on Beth Malicki's Facebook page. It is not that the calendar committee isn't asking for input, but like it happens so often in our district, the community provides input and the community does not get feedback on what everyone's input was. The calendar committee used research for professional learning communities, which wasn't shared with the community. Based on the feedback I saw on Beth Malicki's Facebook page, a middle-of-the-ground alternative needs to be proposed before anything is presented to the board. With the proposed calendar, there are weeks with a day off, a full day, then a late start, another week that has a late start before 2 days off. And we don't need two consecutive days off in January. A middle-of-the-ground alternative would be to move the PLC time to Monday mornings or Friday afternoons, and move that January 17th to a Monday in February. This middle of the ground alternative, it's not perfect for everyone, but it's the middle of the ground. And to foster relationships that matter most, communication must be used in both directions. Let us use all the tools available to foster our relationships. Thank you.
Thank you, Lawrence. We appreciate your comments. All right, we'll go ahead and move on next to the consent agenda. Are there any items that any board member would like to pull for further discussion or a separate vote? Mary?
Yeah, I would like to pull BA16-012/03 for discussion, and then I would like to pull BA16-145 for discussion as well.
So, EA 16012.
That would be 508, 509, 510 for okay. Voluntary retirement.
All right. So, and should we? We'll go ahead and just start with the voluntary retirement with the 16012. And you have specific questions you want to discuss?
Yeah, I wanted to ask Laurel or Dr. Buck if there's a lot of change from the previous retirement package, voluntary retirement, as it is stated now. Is it the same? A little different? How so?
Yeah, so there are some wording changes. I'm going to hand it over to Jill. She deals substantively if that's, yeah.
There are no material changes right. in the policy. It may have looked like it in one with support staff, only because the amount was a wrong amount, so we crossed out that sentence and because so that it would just reflect the new amount. But other than that, the language is the same.
Okay.
Yeah. There was no material changes.
That's what I thought, yeah. But I think that there were some questions around it, so I wanted to make sure that we publicly stated on record that it was materially the same.
Yeah, and thank you for that question, Mary, because we were getting feedback today as well, and we dug into, we thought maybe we had put something in there that was incorrect or something because the intent was that it not be a material change. Yeah.
Right, yeah, right. So. Okay, thanks okay. for that clarification.
And I have clarified that with the party who brought that to your
okay.
attention.
Okay, very good.
Good.
You had a question?
This summer I have my comment sheet that I think it'd be helpful to have a synopsis ahead of these long documents where you got to compare this one with that one and just say up front, there is a change, this is where it's at, or there's no material changes. Because I, too, spent time kind of reading those like, what am I missing here?
I like that suggestion. We could do like a pertinent synopsis. Facts that would accompany these to say either this represents the same as the year before, mm-hmm. or here are the changes that you should take a look at. I agree with that.
That would be helpful.
Our former attorneys wrote those long documents, so I tried to fix them a little bit.
All right. Any other comments on that particular subject? All right.
Thank you, Jill.
Thank you, Jill. We appreciate that. And then moving on to BA 16145, that's related to the buses. You have a specific question on that?
I did. I know fuel source is always a big topic of conversation for all fleets, whether it be city municipalities or certainly school districts. So I just wanted to talk about LP versus CNG versus diesel versus any other options that are out there. I know 2 years ago working at Lion Energy that there was a significant LP shortage. And I know that a lot of utilities gathered together to try to make sure that we could help alleviate that problem. So when I saw this, I just kind of wanted to discuss it more.
Thank you, and certainly want clarity on moving forward with any proposals, and thank you for the consideration and time for those. I brought along Dwight Hozeal, who's our school bus sales representative and has a wealth of knowledge in terms of the propane versus CNG diesel. Some vehicle maintenance costs, obviously, that would go into effect over the years with the purchase of this type, and the differences, and he'll be an expert in terms of explaining why it's beneficial at this point in time to consider propane.
Big burden on you.
And we might want to clarify what CNG is. I'm not sure everybody understands what that acronym is for.
Compressed natural gas. Basically, when you start looking at alternative fuels, you got compressed natural gas and you got propane. In the school bus industry, most everything has leaned toward the propane. And to be upfront with you, there's no compressed natural gas in the state of Iowa in a school district at this point in time. I happen to be texting back there my alternative fuel division at Bluebird trying to find out, you know, what is out there nationwide. It's very few. It's extremely expensive for infrastructure up front, for building conversions, and then for the purchase of the equipment. Propane is the alternative to that because it's a lot less to buy up front as far as the buses, and you can see that by the tabulation of your bids. And then also your infrastructure is a lot less. And more importantly, it's a lot easier for your mechanics and stuff to work on that. I'm going to bounce around a little bit here, but to answer your question about the propane, I know what you're talking about. It was about 2 years ago, propane hit $5 a gallon, scared the living heck out of everyone. That literally was in the upper Midwest. And there was cause of that for about three different reasons. Number one is that we actually jumped our outsourcing of propane to about 20%. What ended up happening is that we could handle that, sustain that number, but we had an extremely cold winter and we had extremely wet grain. So what ended up happening is they started using more propane in Canada, Canada come to Minnesota, Minnesota come to Iowa, and it just sort of kept going down. But the nice thing about that is the school districts that we had already converted to propane were under contract and they were unaffected by those price hikes. So that's something that we always want you to look at when you do go to propane, is that in some cases you can lock up to a two-year price guarantee. So that's beneficial to help in those situations. If you start looking at the shelves around the United States, there is actually enough propane, and this is not coming from me, it's coming from experts and meetings that I've set into, that would actually supply all the homes, the vehicles of everyone in this United States for over 100 years. So it was basically a supply and demand issue. It wasn't that there was a shortage of propane, it just happened to be isolated right into our neck of the woods, which was the upper Midwest. We were bringing buses in from south. We were worried about it because we speculate on transportation costs 6 months in advance. So I had four of them sold going to Kyoto. So we're going, okay, is our profits going to transportation costs because they surcharges for it? Come to find out they didn't, because none of the propane charges even hit until they got into Missouri. So that addresses maybe a little bit of what you're asking about that. Now, propane in general, the reason we started looking at it, and I've been selling it for about 6-7 years now. We converted to our new system 3 years ago, which is done by Roush. It's a phenomenal system. When I first started doing it, diesel was $5 a gallon, propane was $2.50. And then you factor in a 50-cent credit that the federal government was offering. Even though you were paying more for the propane, you were having your money back in about 2.5 years. So we were looking at that. But as we've extended further into emission diesels, and I'm sure you guys are somewhat aware of emission diesels. Denny's probably been reporting back to you. When those first started hitting us in 2007, they were said, oh, we won't have many issues with these things. What we're finding out is the semis that are running from New York to Los Angeles, they don't have a lot of issues. But in school buses, delivery trucks that are stopping, going, and idling all the time, they've become a real nightmare. The particulate filters are plugging up. They constantly got warning lights on, and they're costing districts a lot of money. That's where propane has become the alternative to that. So we have less maintenance, but we have a lot less repair. So when I've been going to school board meetings over the last year, we spend more time looking at maintenance costs versus fuel savings. Even though you'll have fuel savings, but that maintenance cost has become a bigger deal. When you start looking at a particulate filter, which is part of the exhaust system, if that happens to go to Cummins to be repaired, you could be $6,000 to $8,000 just for one exhaust system. You start doing that two or three times on owning that bus for the fleet you guys have, it gets extremely expensive. And that's where the propane has become very attractive.
I appreciate your response. So how many districts in the state of Iowa have switched to LP?
What I did is I did a quick little deal here. In the state of Iowa, I don't have the exact number right off the top of my head. Denny's going to pass out a sheet here. And I did this sheet in two different ways when I was asked to do this tonight. The top sheet is existing customers that we've actually got feedback by or from the customer. The back sheet is basically all the customers in Iowa that have switched. Some of them are newly switched, so we don't have feedback. And if you look over on the right-hand side, there was two schools that converted this year that we just did last month, which happened to be Muscatine and North Scott.
All that many, because we have how many school districts in the state of Iowa?
I can't answer that question.
350, I think. Okay.
Yeah. Let me put it to you this way, and rather than looking at the district, right now with Bluebird and our Roush propane system, over 30% of all our, it's in our conventional bus only, so over 30% of all our sales right now are going propane. That's a pretty substantial number. Now, I'm going to put this in retrospect nationwide. We have over 6,000 units running with over 60 million miles on them. I won't comment on our competitors, but we're the leader in as far as propane goes. We got into it because we seen there was a future in it, and it's been paying very dividends to us because we're putting out a bus that's operating relatively trouble-free.
Okay. I just still have a little discomfort about this because maybe I don't have enough information. I do know the city of Marion is switching their fuel source for their fleet to compressed natural gas. And so I kind of want, maybe it's beneficial for us to have a conversation with them. They've been studying it for several years. And I think for them to switch their entire fleet for the city is pretty significant.
Mm-hmm.
But those are just my thoughts.
Any other? Keith?
I was going to bring this issue up, too. I know there's some fleets that are going back to gasoline engines.
Yes. We have introduced a gasoline bus. Once again, it's interesting. We had our, I don't know how many of you were at the school board show, but we had our demo bus up there. It's a new gas bus that Bluebird has brung out. And I had board members walking up and going, gas, why gas? I thought we were done with gas. We wouldn't see propane today, or would we see gas today if it wasn't for all the problems with the emission diesels. The motor of the diesel is fine. It's all the emissions that the government has mandated that we've added to is where we're creating all our costs. The thing with the gas bus, it's going to be a little bit cheaper to buy, but it's going to have a little bit more day-to-day cost of operation. So when we start categorizing, overlooking at 10 to 12 years, the propane is going to be the cheapest bus to own for the school district to give you the most savings. The gas is going to be number two, and then with the repair costs we're seeing on the diesel, it's definitely going to be number three. So.
But one advantage of the gasoline engine is the fuel is readily available.
Yes.
And if you track what's happened in the last 6 months, who knows, you know, where it's gone. But I mean, these are dynamic pricing models. And that's a really proven engine, as is the diesel, except for the emissions problems.
Now,
I just ask along with that. I remember when I was on the farm, farmers did not like propane because hard starting.
Yep. Can I address that? Because I was going to get there, and that's a great question. I'm glad you finally asked that. The propane you're talking about is an old vapor system. It was a nightmare. The new system is a direct injected system, so it never goes to vapor. It's in a liquid form for when it leaves its source of its tank into our tank through our fuel lines to the engine intake. So here's the advantage of a direct injected liquid system. We use a fuel pumps in the tank, but this is probably the most impressive thing. In Canada, 25 to 30 below zero, not plugged in, these things still start. So the cold weather and the quick warm-up is not an issue like what you were talking about with your old vapor system. And that's been a great selling point of the propane, especially when you start getting up north into the northern Minnesota, the Canada, and those areas, is because of that cold weather performance. I've actually had these on my lot 3 years ago when the winter was down to about 25 below, not plugged in, sitting in our back lot. We had no problem starting any of them. So that is definitely an advantage of the propane. If you look over at the Omaha Public School District, they purchased over 450 of these in 2013. When they start evaluating their savings between fuel, maintenance, labor, and electricity, they're seeing annual savings of over $200,000. And STA is that private contractor. They have continued to buy more propanes from us. They bought close to 90 for a school district in Colorado and some other districts that they have landed. They're committed to staying with the propane.
So tell me again, so you do not have a compressed natural gas?
Yes, we do.
You do?
Yep.
Okay.
Right now, compressed natural gas is in a rear engine bus, but all three of our two competitors and ourselves are looking at bringing it out in the front engine or the conventional style school bus.
Okay. Any other comments about this? Yeah, Gary?
We currently have gasoline tanks on site, correct? I mean, we
diesel.
Stockpile?
Yes.
What will we have to purchase, or will we have to obtain propane tanks then in order to supply these and an additional cost?
Currently, Linmar is about a year ahead of us with the propane bus acquisitions. And they have are leasing equipment from a vendor. The cost to the district was approximately $27,000 for a 1,000-gallon tank setup. We are looking to go probably initially a 1,000-gallon tank on a concrete pad that, in just preliminary discussions with Rob, $10,000 to $12,000 with the ability to add two more tanks as we add buses in the future. So starting out with seven. A 1,000-gallon tank would meet our needs for 3 to 5 years based off fuel consumption. And Like I said, we're a year behind kind of what Linmar is trying. They have four buses currently, approximately saving $3,000 a year in operating costs per bus is what their preliminary numbers show. So as far as a fuel site, we do have the space and the availability. I think we have of our three fuel tanks, fuel pumps, the one pump would be removed and an LP tank or pump would be put in that place. So the infrastructure is there. It's a minor change of the fueling system.
Keith? No. Any other questions?
Yeah, just a quick question. So the maintenance staff that would maintain, you know, this new fleet of LP buses, would they have to undergo additional training or certifications to be able to perform that work as time goes on? Or is it there, or?
We just talked about that tonight. I'll let Dwight share a little bit with our
current staff. This is the exciting thing about this program. I don't know how many are familiar with Roush, Jack Roush, Roush Enterprises. That's who we're teamed up with. They're supplying the propane part of it. Then we use a Ford motor and a Ford transmission. We can actually, if your mechanics wish to do so, we can actually get them what they call Roush certified so that they can do service right in your location. Now, we highly recommend the Ford tool to do this and then an annual fee. So your initial upfront cost will be about $2,000. With what's happening over at Linmar and surrounding schools, Roush is looking at coming into a specific location and doing a 2 to 3 day training class, which would certify your mechanics. So because we're really taking a gasoline motor and adding the propane conversion to that, it's relatively simple. We're using a Ford V10 with a Ford transmission. The other thing that I'll be working on extensively is getting a Ford dealer set up. So you then become, or for Denny and his mechanics, you become a one-stop shop. So now with a diesel, you go somewhere to have the diesel worked on, you go somewhere else to have the transmission worked on. With this product, we can do it all in-house. One of the other little comments about when you talk in service, when this product first came out, it came out with a 5-year, 100,000-mile warranty on it. Ford Roush has come together and said it is our lowest warranty cost vehicle that we own, so we've eliminated the 100,000 miles. We're now 5 years unlimited. Most school districts in Iowa, that doesn't impact them at all, but you take that private contractor out in Omaha that's leasing those units out during the summer months, that unlimited miles is a big thing because they'll average 25 to 30,000 miles a year. So they're standing behind the product. The other comment that I was going to add real quickly, when we talked about how many school districts had it in Iowa, that's a growing thing, and it's a growing number that's quickly. But what's more important to me than that number is how many are coming back and purchasing the second, third, and fourth one. That's been very successful. Vinton Shelsburg in this area was probably one of our first. They bought two units. They're buying another unit tonight that will put them up to a total of six units in about the last 18 months. I have not had any propane customer go propane and then go back to diesel once they get them.
Any other comments or questions? Are you comfortable with this, or do we need to hold off a little bit and get more information?
Is it possible for us to hold off so we can gather some additional information before we decide to make a purchase?
Where are we with that, Denny, in terms of the process? So you could wait until the January board meeting?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So.
I would prefer we do that.
Yeah. Okay. So are we okay? We would just pull that item and table it until the January 11th board meeting?
Yeah,
so what are the specific items you need additional information about to help make this decision? It'd be, so we just know what to...
Yeah, specific items you would like to know more about.
More on the CNG.
I can send that to you? Can I send that to you?
Yeah, that's
okay.
Fine. Okay, so we'll go ahead and pull the BA-16-145 regarding the buses. We'll table that until the January 11th meeting. And if you have questions, please let Dr. Buck know that directly. Okay? All right, any other consent agenda items we need to pull for questions or comments?
Okay.
With that, would somebody like to make a motion?
Motion to approve the consent agenda minus BA-16-145.
Great, is there a second?
Second.
This is a roll call.
Director Westerkamp?
Aye.
Director Humbles?
Aye.
Director Jacobo?
Aye.
Director Meisterling?
Aye.
Director
Anhalt? Aye.
Director Jansen?
Aye.
President Laverty?
Aye. All right. We have the revised agenda is the Cedar Rapids Community Schools Foundation will not be able to join us tonight. We'll reschedule them for an upcoming meeting. So we'll go ahead and move on to BA-16-159, the proposed 2016-2017 physical plan and equipment projects. And this is a voice vote, but before that, are there any questions or comments about any of those PEPL projects? All right, seeing none, this is a voice vote. All of those in favor of approving the proposed physical plan and equipment projects signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, the same? Abstentions? So the motion passes. All right, BA-16-160 is the comprehensive annual fiscal report, the CAFR. I'll turn that over to Steve. Is Steve here? No?
Just stepped out. Okay.
Did you hear Rob's feelings?
Yeah, well, he was just going to do a quick report on the PEPL, but it's okay.
Yeah. Oh, is that on here?
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Hey, you know, Rob, come on up. Come on up.
I thought I was out of here.
Apologies. I have my notes here. I'm just cranking right along.
That's okay, John.
There
that's
you go.
Right.
It's all yours.
Well, no, first
we love
of all,
it.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you for the opportunity tonight. First of all, I got to say thank you to Marcia. The video is outstanding and showing that PEPL, the PEPL work that we did over the summer with those kids, that's outstanding. What you see on the displayed on the board here is our year one projects, and it's kind of our report card that we have in Buildings and Grounds to track our progress, how we're doing. The green is our completed projects. The yellow are deferred or on hold for a time period. The white are still projects that we still have yet to complete, and the gray are in progress right now. So that completes our year one project with a budget of about $6.8 million. So we're on target to complete by June 30th of next year to complete all of these projects. The next slide shows our year two projects that we have coming up that we're asking for support tonight on. And the year two projects has a budget of about $8.6 million. Now represented on this report card are only approximately about $7.2 million because this year we're bankrolling for year four because we want to do an HVAC project at Grant. These projects represent about $7.2 million. And we will hold some funds till year four to do that grant project. But as you can see on the board, we do have a couple of colored items already that we had to push forward till last year. Hiawatha, we had a fire alarm upgrade that at Hiawatha we had a problem with it, and we had to push that one forward and go ahead and fund that one because of an issue there. And then Monroe, the burglar alarm upgrade, we are holding on that one to see what Monroe brings to us down the road here. But we won't do anything at that facility for a while until we see what happens with that building. But everything else is all ready to go, and we're ready to start our year two projects. We're ready to start planning and start getting things out for bid. So,
awesome. Questions for Rob?
Comment? Thank you. This is very comprehensive, and we thank our voters for supporting our PEPL levy. I assume, and I haven't been around to all of our schools, I assume we have some kind of public acknowledgement of how those funds are spent, either walking in the door or...
Whenever we have a project that is going on, you'll see a little, in our smaller projects, you'll see a little like a real estate sign out front saying thanking our community for the support on any of those smaller projects. Obviously, larger projects, we put a larger sign out there. But.
Great, thank you.
Other questions? Gary?
As I go through this this second year, I see tuck pointing at a couple of the middle schools. Did we not do some extensive tuck pointing work not too long ago at those?
Your point there of extensive. We budget about $70,000 to $100,000 somewhere in that year for middle schools. Typical middle school size of ours are about $1 million to do the entire tuck pointing. And so we're attacking it small portions at a summer. That dollar amount is really good for our local contractors in doing that amount of work over the summertime. Taking on a larger project would be very extensive, and we would be into the school year, which creates a lot of noise as far as tuck pointing, a lot of dust. So we're trying to accomplish these in small small increments during the summertime. That's why you'll see, you know, Wilson probably or McKinley or probably been on there a couple of times. You'll see them on there just because we have a lot of work to do with those buildings and a lot of need. But we didn't want to spend $1 million right off bat at one facility.
Great. Keith?
You just hit on one of my points that this is great that we're doing this, but we still have a shortage. And I think we need to get that message out there that this is the needs are being met, but this is what is also needed over and above that. So the public doesn't come down and say, well, why didn't you tell us?
No, I would agree with that. In our study that we did about 2 or 3 years ago, we got $20 million worth of need a year. We got $8.6 million worth. And so the need is definitely there. As if we took all of our, just our tuck pointing that we need in the district, that could very well take our $8.6 million up in one year. And so you're right, there is a large need there. We have some HVAC projects that are really in dire need as well. So
roofs, et cetera. I think I'm just saying that message still needs to be out there. And I'm personally, we're on a railroad crash or train wreck on this one.
I think it's important to note that the board does have the long-term facilities master plan on our agenda for this spring. So we'll be having that conversation as we move forward in the next few months. Other comments or questions? I do apologize sincerely for that.
No problem.
And Laurel, should we re-vote on this at this?
We're
good on the vote, so okay. You still all are okay, right? Okay, all right. Thanks, Rob, appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, next we'll move on to Steve Graham for the CAFR Comprehensive Annual Financial Report. And Steve, I will give you the podium. Be my guest.
Thank you, President Laverty. I very much appreciate that. Members of the board, Superintendent Buck, it's my distinct pleasure to have Heidi Hopekirk here with RSM, formerly known as McGlattery, RSM US LLP. So there's a big acronym for you. You have at your desks three documents that all arrived here on Friday. So I'm going to let Heidi explain to you what two of those are. One of them I can easily say is the PowerPoint presentation that you're about to see from Heidi. And before I turn it over to Heidi, I just want to publicly acknowledge a lot of hard work, a lot of fine work by a lot of people. But one of them is sitting right over here, our manager of accounting, Sherry Lusky, is the one that Heidi bothers and all those within the McGlattery firm or RSM firm bothers on a daily basis, putting out, you know, all the information that Sherry does. So it is a lot of work, and it's sort of behind the scenes, and I just want to acknowledge the fact that Sherry does a ton of work on this CAFR document. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Heidi.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Steve. Thank you for having me this evening. As Steve did say, I'm Heidi with RSM, formerly McGlattery. The presentation is what we are going to go through, but it is a short summary of the other two pieces of information that you received, which I'll be covering tonight on my agenda. The first one, the report to the board, which is a summary of our auditor communications to you as the board. And then also summarizing the financial information along with the compliance report. And that information is in the bigger bound packet, which is the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, or CAFR, the abbreviation. And that includes all your financial information, the footnote disclosures, a lot of information, but it also includes Steve's management discussion and analysis, which is a nice summary from your management on what's been going on in regards to the financial information also. So I would recommend that you read that within the CAFR, if nothing else, because it's a nice summary also in addition to my presentation. So first I'll cover the auditor communications. The first item is to let you know the district received an unmodified opinion over your financial information. And that tells you that your financial statements are not materially misstated. So it's the cleanest, it's a clean opinion and the best opinion that you can receive. So I do congratulate you on that achievement. Next is the adoptions of new pronouncements. In the current year, the district did adopt a significant new pronouncement. GASB 68 and 71 are the pension liability GASBs that came into play. So within the financial statements, you're going to see some new information on the financial statements themselves. Now you have a net pension liability along with some deferred inflows and outflows related to that pension, related to your IPERS pension plan that you participate in. And those amounts are the district's proportionate share of the overall plan, because it is a cost-sharing plan, so you have a portion of that. Along with putting those on in the current year, there was also a restatement due to the implementation. I want to stress here that the restatement's not due to an error, it's due to the implementation of the standard itself. So it went back and looked as though that standard was in place in the prior year, what those beginning amounts would be, and then adjust it through the current year to get you to the ending balances this year. Along with the change in those dollars amounts, it also significantly changed the disclosure. You went from about a half-page disclosure about your pension plan to about 5 pages. So there's a lot of information within the disclosure that's required under the GASB that talks about the plan in general, talks about the amounts that you recorded, and the actuarial assumptions that were used in calculating those amounts. So if you would compare this year's financials to the prior year, you are going to see a change around those pension amounts.
Can we ask questions while we go?
Yes.
So basically, does that state that if the state of Iowa is not able to currently fund IPERS, then the school district has the responsibility to do that in its entirety?
The school district is responsible for your portion of the unfunded liability. So the net pension liability that is recorded is an actuarially calculated amount that the plan as a whole has, and then that's allocated out to all the participants within the plan based on their proportionate share, which is basically based on your contributions into the plan compared to all the other employers. So the amount you're recording is only the district's portion, and that can change over the years, which is part of that calculation and some of those deferred inflows and outflows. But it's the amount that the plan is unfunded currently.
So when you all have an opportunity to look at those numbers, they're pretty scary. But just so you have an understanding of that, because it is the first time that we're seeing those.
Yes, they are large, and they're large for everyone, and not only in the state of Iowa, but across the nation.
Thank you.
Yes, any other questions in regards to the pension?
Okay. Well, the other part of that is, though, that we have no say or input in that, except maybe through a legislative process, even that's questionable. So we get it on our balance sheet, and we don't have a voice.
You are correct, because the plan is making those assumptions and making those determinations. Now, as an employer, you can talk to the plan and maybe have some influence, but when you're one of many, it makes it more difficult. Okay. The next item is to let you know that your financial statements, along with all others, have management judgments and estimates. And as part of the audit process, we review those significant estimates and review what management does to come up with those. We do detail them out in the stapled report, what those significant ones are that we reviewed, but I would state here that when we did our review of those estimates, we concurred or agreed with what management used as those estimates and believed that they were reasonable for the district. There were 2 audit adjustments that were proposed as part of the process by us, and management agreed to. They posted those, and they are reflected within the financial statements, and they were in regards to some capital assets and also a receivable. There were also a couple uncorrected misstatements. These are items that management believed were immaterial to the financial statements, and we agreed with those, but they are reported because they're above what our auditor threshold is to just pass on them. These adjustments will be corrected in the future, most likely in 2016, and we did not consider them material, so that did not have an impact on your opinion. And then, as you can note here, we had no disagreements with management. There were no significant issues discussed, nor did we have any difficulties performing the audit. Oops. Next, we'll summarize some financial information at a high level. The first slide here is your revenue for all governmental funds. Overall, you saw an increase of about $7.5 million in revenue, or about 3.3%. From the chart, you can see the largest increase was in your state sources. And this included, basically came from two areas. It was about a $10 million increase in that source. The first one was related to your new teacher leadership grant, and you received about $5 million related to that. And then you also saw an increase in state aid compared to the last year of about $5 million. The federal sources, which is where your federal grants are reported, there was a slight decrease in there. I just want to point that out. That's due to the FEMA money, the final revenue source of FEMA dollars that you received in the prior year that wasn't expected again in the current year. Next is the expenditures for those same governmental funds. And here you saw an increase of about $5.4 million, or 2.4%. And the largest increase here is in the support services. And the grant that I just mentioned on the previous slide for the new teacher leadership, you had expenditures related to that. So those were recorded within the support services, and there was about a $5 million increase there, very similar to your overall increase. I would point out that your capital outlay had a slight decrease of about $2 million. This is due to timing of those various projects under the SAVE dollars and the PEBL. This slide represents your enterprise funds, which is your nutrition fund and your daycare services. This is presented a little bit differently because it is an enterprise fund from those governmental funds that we just talked about. Your operating revenue was pretty consistent with the prior year. You did see a decrease in operating expenditures as there was some administrative costs that are now being paid by a governmental fund. Your non-operating revenues were consistent with the prior year, but I always like to point out what's included in this category, and those are your federal and state grants that you receive for these programs, mainly your nutrition program, along with your interest income is showing in those non-operating revenues. And then the change in net position not only includes the first three columns on the chart, but also the transfers in and out of these funds. And you saw a change in net position in the current year of a positive $418,000 for the two funds. The next part that I'm going to discuss is the compliance reporting. There's two other sets of standards that we audit the district under. The first one is governmental auditing standards. This is where we review your internal controls, look over your checks and balances that you have in place at the district. I'm happy to report that there were no deficiencies reported under the governmental auditing standards, and there was also no compliance findings reported under these same standards. Now, within the schedule of findings and question costs that report none under the governmental auditing standards, in a minute I'll let you know about the single audit. There is a section that the state auditors require that we report under, so there's some additional verbiage which within that section. Most of those items were reporting that we did not see anything and there was nothing to report. The only area, as the district has had in the past, is sometimes there's certified enrollment reconciling items between the state and the district, which the district reviewed and has reconciled with the state, but we're required by the state to report that there. The last audit that we perform is the single audit, where we look at your federal expenditures or those federal grants. We tested one major program this year, the Child Nutrition Cluster, and that provided us 53% coverage of your federal dollars expended in the current year. You did receive an unmodified or clean opinion over that specific program, and also the district had no compliance findings related to the program either, so a very clean audit for your single audit also. That ends my formal presentation, so I would like to thank you for your time this evening. I also want to thank Steve and Sherry and all the other departments within the district that provide us information and that my team does bother and get information from. We know we're disruptive. We know you like to see us go away, but we couldn't do it with all of their help, so we do thank them for all of that. And at this point, I would just open up for any questions either on what I presented or anything that I didn't present.
Thank you. Questions for Heidi? Or any others?
I wonder if we can receive this information prior to our board meeting so that I could feel more comfortable about asking questions.
Okay. Yeah, that would be very helpful. It gives us an opportunity to process.
Yeah.
so we can come up with some questions.
Sure. And if you have any questions after you've been able to review it, Steve has our contact information, or you can send questions through him. I'd be more than happy to talk to any of you.
Gary?
This may be a question more for Steve. Does the, with the new addition of the of Gadsby and the IPERS impact, does that have any impact on our bonding rate? Does that have any overall financial impact? I mean, it's basically, it is, it's just on paper. Does having those numbers on paper have any negative aspect to our operation?
That's a very excellent question, and I cannot honestly give you an answer that I believe is accurate. I don't know how you can you respond to that one at all.
I would agree with. I'm not sure I can give you an accurate answer. What I can tell you is the credit agencies have been telling us they've always been aware that these liabilities are out there, and they've had their own mechanism of looking at them. We haven't seen, because everyone just started implementing it June 30th this year, we haven't seen the impact yet from any of the credit agencies to see if actually having it within your financials would change how they are looking at it compared to how they've looked at it in the past.
Ask again next year.
Yeah.
Okay.
Other questions? Keith?
What's the availability of these reports to the public?
On the district website, we have, I believe we go back maybe 10 years of CAFRs, and we'll have a PDF file posted on the website, I would hope, before this week is over with. We waited until the board meeting for the board to review this and have opportunity for questions and answers, but we'll have this new iteration posted on the website quickly.
Thank you.
Great. Any other comments, questions? All right, Heidi and Steve and Sherry, thank you so much for this, and it's great news that everything passed with flying colors. So thanks for all your effort.
Thank you.
All right.
That requires a voice vote.
Sorry about that. So for BA 16160, Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, all those in favor of approving the report signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, same. Abstain? None. The motion passes, so thank you so much for that. We'll go ahead and move on. Steve, you're back at the podium. All right. You didn't even have to leave. Okay. So the fiscal year 2016-2017 budget assumptions and information. We're all on pins and needles about
all
this,
right,
as we go into our legislative session. So
thank you, President Laverty, Board of Education, Superintendent Buck. We have essentially three fiscal periods in which we manage all at one time, it seems. We just listened to Heidi talk about our fiscal 15 and end of year financial report. We're in the middle of the fiscal 16 budget. We're working on that, and here we are talking about fiscal 17. So there's an ongoing effort on multiple years simultaneously, and that's sort of the story here. But fiscal 17, this sort of is the kickoff season of looking at what's coming up next down the road. We don't know what SSA is and what is SSA, State Supplemental Assistance. You'll hear SSA a lot through the course of the presentation. There are a lot of unknowns, but there are a lot of some things that we do know. And so the idea here is to go through 10 topics or 10 categories called assumptions, and we call it assumptions and information. And what I'm going to make sure I do is stop frequently, look for understanding, and certainly an opportunity to ask questions as I proceed here along with the presentation. So assumption number one is to maintain a stable property tax levy rate. And so we all have a mutual desire to look very, very carefully at that levy rate each year and provide the best value for the tax dollar. As we put a budget together. And I've got a slide on showing you the trends of property tax levies and show you where we stand. Even with the successful passage of the PEPL levy, which doubled the voter-approved levy from 67 cents to $1.34, We included that in our fiscal 16 budget. Even with that, we actually reduced the levy rate by 10 cents. And a lot of that had to do with what was going on at the state level in terms of property tax relief, commercial property tax relief. And so it had a beneficial impact on us, but still, we did absorb a significant increase in the PEPL levy without an overall increase. Here is our comparability with the 11 Linn County public school districts, and you'll see Cedar Rapids is the second lowest levy rate district in Linn County. Just some perspective. Budget assumption number two is that the district will likely experience low to moderate growth in their property tax base. I can't tell you what the numbers will look like when they come in for January, which will be our base for fiscal 17, but I can tell you that our growth over just in 1 year in fiscal 16 was dismal at less than 1%, and an average growth rate over 10 years of 2%. When you have a growth rate of your tax base that is exceeded by a growth rate in your revenue needs, you have that tendency towards upward momentum or upward pressure on the property tax levy rate. And this has been our experience here because of our low growth of our property base valuation. And here's the graphic, 10 years, there's your trend. You can see it's a growth, but it's not a rigorous growth. It's a fairly flatline growth. Budget assumption number three is that we will continue, as promised, to provide a $40 million property tax relief through the use of our saved dollars. So fiscal 17 will be the second to the last year of a $4 million reduction of our property tax levy rate, which is about 75 cents, by using $4 million of saved funds in 17 to reduce property tax rate. Now in fiscal 18, which is the last year, it's actually going to be $2 million. So at the end of 17, we'll have paid back $38 million of the $40 million of saved funds towards property tax relief. Does that make sense? Okay. Budget assumption number four is state supplemental aid for fiscal 17 will be similar for fiscal 16. Well, I typed it out. I thought, I'll put it out there. Do we really know what it's going to be? No, we don't know what it's going to be at this point in time. I did indicate the effect of the open enrollment on our overall growth. If you look at the certified enrollment increase of 97 students, which is a good thing, it's a 0.58% growth of student enrollment. But if you look at the whole picture, you look at 45 students who are netting out an open enrollment away from our district, it's an incremental change. So our real growth is 52 students, or 0.31%. Still, it's growth, which is a good thing. I've given you four examples at the bottom of the slide. 2% increase in state supplemental aid would equate to 2.25% growth in new money, or 1.25% equates to 1.46% growth in new money. So we'll see what happens. Hopefully the legislature will take action in the first 30 days of the cycle and provide us that number that we're looking for. Here are our budget enrollment trends. I say budget enrollment. This is the resident pupils. This is the certified count on that second October day, the first weekday of October officially, that drives our finances for the upcoming fiscal year. You can see the bar is up, but the full picture again is open enrollment. Okay, and this is the open enrollment trend that we have. That red line is the net out-migration of open enrollment students from 1 year to the next. And you can see as it's going down, the disparity between open enrollment in and open enrollment out is growing. The good news here is that for fiscal 16, our net out-migration is 45, which is less than what it was the prior period. So it's good. It's certainly an improvement. Hopefully that can continue and give us some assistance there. Budget assumption number five is that budget adjustments will likely be necessary. when we're planning our fiscal 17 budget. We, in the current fiscal period, had a $2.5 million budget adjustments to maintain stability with our spending authority. Spending authority is the most important indicator of stability of the general fund, more so than our fund balance. It's the authority, the spending authority. And because we have a very narrow margin of 2% on that spending authority, looking at fiscal 17 with, frankly, the growth rate, which is unknown, and we have a second year settlement with our teaching staff at 3.5% total package. We don't know, there's a question mark on the other employee work groups, but we do know that we have a second year settlement of 3.5% with our teaching group. So we'll see what happens in 17. There's our unspent balance, our spending authority, and you'll see the forecast for fiscal 16 is a little bit down from where it was when we closed fiscal 15, but we have ended this very sharp decline of our spending authority, and we've made those adjustments, and we're in a much more stable situation now, a much more manageable situation now than we were just several years ago. So good work there. And our fund balance, again, it's the second, and when it comes to the spending authority, which is more important, this is also important. This is what bond rating agencies like Moody's and S&P love. They love to see improvements in your financial cash in the bank. And this is essentially what fund balance is all about. It's, again, we have a lot of money, but we have little authority to spend it. That's what we have here.
So, Steve, just to clarify, that's the superintendent in Davenport, that's the issue that he was trying to address, that we have funds in the bank in our checkbook, but we don't have the authority from the bank to actually go out and spend that money, right?
Davenport superintendent is saying, if you gave us the state cost per pupil in Davenport, if you gave us the highest district cost per pupil, and there's $173 disparity between the high and the low, in Davenport it would be $3 million. And you look at this chart right here, every bar would be up $3 million higher in Davenport if the authority was granted across the state for the highest district cost per pupil. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Budget assumption number six, a review of staff allocations is something that we do each year, and looking at what we do in fiscal 17 is part of the budgeting process. And I have here the class size targets over the last 5 years, and you'll see that the numbers, I believe, are all exactly the same. So there has not been a change in our class size targets that we've had, which comprise the vast majority of our budget expenditures. Budget assumption number seven is that we will continue to arrive at fair and equitable settlements. Again, as I said earlier, we have already settled with our teachers group at 3.5%. 82% of what we spend our general fund monies on are compensation. The cash reserve levy has been used to improve our fund reserves. You saw how they're going up very, very nicely. In fiscal 17, we have the opportunity to revisit what we're levying in cash reserve, sort of a balancing of need versus our property tax levy, and see how that all kind of fits together. And certainly there'll be multitudes of options available that we'll be able to bring to you for consideration. We are sitting very nicely. This is the financial solvency ratio. Look at the great strides we've made over the last several years. We are in the target range, and it's all a result of reductions of budget and of increases in that cash reserve levy position. And this is a cash reserve levy. We're currently at $13.32 million. This is what we are adding to our cash flow from local property tax dollars at this point in time. Budget assumption number nine is that we rely on categorical funds. 44% of our staff are supported with categoricals like Perkins. Perkins is probably not a good example. Title I is certainly a good example. Title II dropout prevention. These are all that very much support staffing in our school district. And so each of those are balanced independently and looked at individually, their own little micro budget, when we're looking at how we manage our categorical funds and programs. And the finally, assumption number 10 is that we look at more than just simply the general fund. My conversation with you tonight is largely around the general fund, but we have 8 district funds, and 5 of those funds are supported with property tax dollars. So we have a large budget at $264.1 million, and with that, I'll just stop talking and listen and answer questions if you have any.
Questions for Steve?
Feeling much better than I have in years past. So thank you for your work. Appreciate it.
Other questions, comments?
Thank you for the report.
Okay. Thank
where
you.
Where do we go from here, Steve, then? Well, we'll wait to see what the supplemental aid is and then come back and look at.
This is where the CFO directs his attention towards the superintendent, says that's Dr. Buck's prerogative, and where we go from here.
Okay.
So that's exactly what this conversation is, because what this hinges on now, so all of the variables are essentially in place, or nearly so, except for state supplemental aid. And so until we know that number, it'll be hard to know.
Yep. What about the sales tax issue that's coming up on machinery and equipment?
What's the net out for us on that, Steve? 180,000 or some kind of number like
that? You know, again, this is where I'm not going to put a number out there. I'm going to go back and promise you I'll give you a number that would affect us if that would come to fruition.
So, I guess, Gary, is this something we need to be contacting legislators about on? I know it's going to affect a lot of agencies, and what's the cost benefit? There's an article in the Gazette about that.
I do believe that there's going to be a very conscious effort by legislation and the governor to adhere to the law and have it settled in the first 30 days. In fact, there's some, I'm hearing some that possibly, you know, the governor in his State of the Union will have his numbers out. He was late even supplying that last year. That'll be up front. I would not hold my breath on seeing an increase with what we're seeing with the revenue estimating conference. I think I have that right. They're projecting a lower income for the state than they were in October. I'm sure legislators will look at that and say, whoa, we're going to have to. If I were going to pull something out, I'd say 2% right now would be a starting point. Don't know. Yes, we need to advocate. We need to do it now, starting now, as they start to go into their committee work and start formulating those budgets. Hopefully, I'll have some more information after workshop tomorrow on what we can do to be better advocates.
That's great.
And Steve, does tax incremental financing have an impact on our finances? I know in college community it's pretty significant, and as I look at economic development activity in Cedar Rapids, it's becoming more. It may become more significant for us.
I will say that TIF is a good thing.
I agree.
TIF is a good thing. The impact on the school district PEPL levy is zero, because TIF values are all included in the PEPL levy, which is a good thing too. And our instructional support levy also is funded with the inclusion of the TIF, but our management fund, our general fund, exclude that TIF component in the calculation. But because of the school funding formula and because of authority and how this all works, it really doesn't have a negative effect other than it provides a little more state aid and a little bit less property tax dollars at the end of the day on the general fund.
One of the issues, though, is some of our neighboring school districts have used TIF for housing versus, I think, in Cedar Rapids, if I'm not mistaken, we're using it more for business and industrial sorts of things. And again, over the last number of years, that makes a difference, doesn't it, in the housing having TIF versus business and industry TIF?
Well, I guess I don't really have...
He's right about the residential units in housing. Yep.
Yeah, I've heard like in Linmar and some of those that's what they've used it for, and it's become an issue for them. So, but there was some other like the Nubo area. They were making another type of district. It wasn't a TIF district, but
it's a SMID.
SMID.
Does that affect any of this at all, or is that no?
Because their money's raised within the SMID, they go back into the development of the SMID.
Very good.
I may be wrong, I have in the past, but I do think some of our larger housing projects maybe are getting some TIF.
They
are. Funding some of the apartment and condo right, some of those that we're seeing spring up across the city, I think are getting some TIF funding.
Was that after flood recovery, or what was that from? Do we know?
Yes. And I think revitalization of the Nubo and downtown urban area.
Okay.
So you've got Kingston Law, all those different condos that are coming up. I believe they have a 10-year, it might be a 5-year abatement, but something to, again, pay attention to, much like the sales tax for commercial and industrial.
Other questions, concerns?
So as it relates to priorities, so Keith, I think you asked a question, too, around priorities. And so there's going to be a lot of competing forces on a little bit of money in this session. Mm-hmm. And so state supplemental aid remains the priority, in my mind, remains the priority because of the net cumulative effect of state supplemental aid. But the manufacturing tax question, the transportation cost question that's in play, the assessment conversation, there are a number, in the final year of the $55 million of the teacher leadership and compensation system. I think it'll be interesting tomorrow night to talk some about strategically, if you had to prioritize where all these money items just for schools, because that doesn't even take into account, you know, we're not the only ones in play for the funding. So I think tomorrow will be an interesting insight.
And there may, although I know we're concerned about supplemental aid, but there may also be some other avenues, mental health services, some other categorical funding that we need help with, mental health, what we're looking at, where they'll proceed with the testing issue. The Smarter Balance has some cost implications to it. So will we get support and help with some of those? So I think there'll also be some side issues, a lot of it revolving around money with a lot of very small amount or smaller amount of new money. From what I've heard, actually what has already been the built-in escalation of budgets actually take care of what the new growth is already. So any additional will be tough to come by.
Raphael, did you have a question?
Just had a quick question. I don't know if Steve, if you could help me with this or not, but spring 2017 with like the third grade substantially deficient summer school thing that's coming up, is that something that would affect the assumptions that we're looking at right now, or is that for the following fiscal year, or would it be? So I think it would be for summer school 2017,
yes,
right?
It would have an impact. If you're talking about something associated with the summer of 2017, that is at the tail end. I'm sorry, that's the tail end of fiscal, 17.
Fiscal 17.
The answer is yes.
Okay. So. Thanks.
He fixed it. Yeah. All right. Other questions or comments? All right. Thank you, Steve, for all your work on this. It'll be a challenge, but I think we're up for it, and I think all of us realize the priority of education in our community and in our state. So hopefully our legislators and governor will give us what we need on that. So next we'll move into learning and leadership, and we have Val and Sheila with our early learning update.
Yes, President Lafferty, Sheila Lehman and I would like to welcome tonight to the podium Kim Hazlett and Marta Hirschner, and they are facilitators with our early learning department, and they're going to share about our 3-4 and young 5-year-old preschool programming.
Good evening, Dr. Buck, President Lafferty, and Board of Directors. We really appreciate this opportunity to share a little bit about our programs tonight. These are some of our philosophy statements, which are found in our parent handbook and our staff handbook. We feel that building a close personal relationship with each child is essential in promoting a positive preschool experience. We know that young children learn best by exploring and interacting with a variety of different types of material and equipment, and this allows them many opportunities to practice and strengthen skill development in ways that best meets their needs. The preschool atmosphere is set up to allow each child to work with others, be a part of a group, and learn to manage their feelings, their wants, and their needs. Our partnership with families allows us to learn their goals and dreams for their child, their expectations, and really helps extend that learning at home. With the joint efforts of many community agencies, we're able to ensure the health and well-being of the children so that they're very fully able to participate in preschool. And finally, we feel that these skills developed in preschool lay a firm foundation for children's future school success. We are currently serving about 860 3-4 and young 5-year-olds in our 11 district buildings. And then we have six community partners, and those include Five Seasons Learning Centers, KinderCare, Linn County Child Development Center, St. Matthew's Preschool, Lovely Lane Preschool, and Trinity Lane Preschool. You'll see the licensure that our teachers obtain. All teachers are required to have early childhood certification, and our district teachers are dual licensed in early childhood and early childhood special ed. We have 8 special ed teachers, and then our 50 plus para educators are highly trained as well. We are required to meet program standards, one of which is NAACI, which stands for National Association for the Education of Young Children. There are over 400 criteria that we must meet. And then the other is through the IQPPS, which is the Iowa Quality Preschool Program Standards, which is really a subset of the NAACI standards through the Department of Education. Our program includes 3 models. The fully included half-day model is for children 3 and 4, both in general education and special education. And those sessions are offered morning and afternoon. And then we have an early childhood special education 5 program that is 4 full days. And those are for young 4-year-olds, and they also include with alternative kindergarten. And this is a co-teaching model. And then we have 4 categorical programs for children with autism and severe disabilities. This slide just kind of shows you our funding sources, who is served in those within those funding sources, and then the current numbers. Statewide voluntary preschool program is just for 4-year-olds, and as you can see, that's district and those community partners that I mentioned before. We were awarded 5 shared visions grants this year for a 5-year grant cycle. That's for 3 and 4-year-old children, and the family's income must be under 130% of the federal poverty index. We have a few tuition 3-year-old children, and then we have another grant from Linn County Early Childhood Iowa. Those are for 3-year-old children, and the guidelines for those families are to qualify under 200% of the poverty index. And then our 2 special education funded groups there include the 3 and 4-year-olds with IEPs, and then those young 5-year-olds. And those numbers reflect current numbers, but of course we know that those will grow as children are staffed throughout the year. And in many of our classrooms, we are braiding 3 and 4 of those different category funds. Parent involvement is a really strong component of our program. It includes home visits before the children start. It includes 2 developmental screening tools that we ask families to complete, and Marta will share a little more about those. 2 conferences during the year, and we also expect classroom participation, which can come in many different forms, family events or field trips, helping in the classroom, that type of thing. And then we really work to communicate with families on a weekly and daily basis, if possible.
Okay, I'm going to share, can you hear me? I'll share about our curriculum and assessment and some data from last year. Early learning curriculum supports the Iowa Early Learning Standards, which are aligned to the Iowa core. And we currently have a team of early learning teachers working with our early office team to develop priority standards and units that our curriculum will support. And the first piece listed here, the creative curriculum, is our overarching piece of curriculum that we use. It's research-based, play-based curriculum, and it balances teacher-directed and student-initiated learning that develops skills through 11 interest areas. And I won't go into the specifics of each of these. We'd be happy to share more if you want, but all are aligned to the Iowa Early Learning Standards, and we have curriculum for literacy, math, and social-emotional behavioral areas. We also have assessment in preschool. We have both formative and summative. And then these are used in our PLC meetings, too, that teachers have. The most comprehensive assessment we have is the Teaching Strategies Gold, which aligns to the creative curriculum that is our overarching curriculum. It's an authentic observational system for children birth to 5, and teachers observe in the everyday context of their classrooms what children know and are able to do. It's comprised of 38 learning objectives, that include predictors of school success and readiness. And it allows teachers to compare each child's knowledge, skills, and behaviors to widely held expectations for children of the same age. And it's now required by the state. So we use it for 4-year-olds, but we use it for all children in our program, 3 to even those young 5-year-olds. The other piece that's up here is Read It Again. And it's a curriculum supplement to develop and strengthen those foundational literacy and language skills for children. It uses a storybook format to build the skills that are listed on the slide. And then it has the key concepts are repeated, and it provides differentiation and kind of gets at those needs for our special learners. Here's some data that we have for 4-year-olds, and I've got 2 graphs here, and I'll do my best to explain it. It's kind of complicated having that much information on the same slide. But the first graph is 4-year-olds, and the second graph is our 4-year-old IEP students from last year. We're looking at 6 domains across the bottom, so it's social, emotional, behavioral, physical, language, cognitive, literacy, and mathematics. And the gold assessment on this chart is looking at emerging and accomplished. So the solid bars in both graphs will show you the number of students that are at that emerging level in the fall and then again in the spring. So this would be fall, this would be spring. And then the dotted bars or the striped bars over here are showing you the children that are at the accomplished level in the spring and the fall. And what you want to see here is that the emerging level is going down and the accomplished level is going up. Does that make sense? It's kind of hard to put a lot on one slide, but anyway, that was an attempt. Read It Again for 4-year-olds. This is data just on our IEP students. And that was our targeted group with Read It Again. So 4 areas are assessed. We have the narrative, phonological awareness, print knowledge and vocabulary, and let's see, it's assessed 4 times a year, so we have week 2, 12, 21, and 30, and we want to see the red, which is the acquiring skills. The yellow is the building, and the green is competent. We want to see that red going down in each area, and the green and the yellow combining together to be at about that 80%. So overall, we're not quite at the 80% with our IEP children, but we're working toward it with the highest level where you can see. So that's that. And then we have some screeners that we use in preschool. The first is the individual growth and development indicators that are a literacy screener and we just use with our four-year-olds, and that's part of the Iowa TEARS system. It's not currently mandated by the state, but we're piloting it in four or five buildings in Cedar Rapids. We also have ages and stages screener, which is a developmental screener that parents fill out for us and helps us red flag those kiddos that we have concerns about their development. We also have the ASQ-SE, which is a social emotional behavioral screener, also completed by parents or families. And then we also screen for dental, vision, hearing, and medical for all of our kiddos. I guess that's it for tonight. Our goal is to ready our children for kindergarten and to close that achievement gap for those strugglers as we work to build strong relationships and success for all our students. So thank you for letting us share with you tonight. Are there any questions?
Programs are having an impact?
That's a good question. Not with us to share tonight, but we certainly could get that.
Right. Val might be able to.
One of the things that we do is we do try to track at least through kindergarten, not so much into first grade. It's a little bit of a power school glitch, I guess I would call it, in how to maintain that information. But buildings have started to track. I know these kids went to a preschool, a Cedar Rapids preschool, and what kinds of things we're seeing with these kids over time. These kids are coming into us in kindergarten much more ready for school, much more ready for learning, and also some of them very successful at learning already.
I ask it pointedly because it's, as we start talking to legislators, we'll have to go back to that. They always will say, well, what is this money being well spent? Are we getting bang for a buck? I know there are sometimes it's hard to put hard data to, we know intuitively that it's making an impact. There are some soft skills that we don't necessarily measure.
Right. I would say, you know, as a former building administrator, as these kids came into us in kindergarten, they had skills that were above those kids that did not have any sort of preschool opportunity. So we can give that data to show the difference. And we still have a number of kids that don't have preschool opportunities in our district.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're excited to see the numbers, your red bars going down and the yellow and green going up. Yep. So keep that up. And it looks like it's darn close to the 80% mark. Yeah. So if we can get there, if there's anything we as a board can do, you know, through Val and the administration, we'd love to hear about that. And again, Kim and Marna, thanks for all you're doing along with Val and and Sheila and their teams. So thank you very much. All right. We'll go ahead and move on to board governance. And Dr. Buck and Laurel, I'll turn this over to you.
Tonight we have the regulations that accompany the policies that you approved tonight under the Voluntary Retirement Incentive Program. And the other regulation that we have for your consideration is student transportation fees, which really just moved from a trimester to a quarterly fee basis. We'd answer any questions that you'd have.
Any questions or comments about the policy manual changes? Okay. Seeing none, we'll go ahead and move on. The last item, we will be going into a closed session for evaluation, and once we go into that, the meeting will be over. At
this time, too, we want to remind the board members that we do have the calendar there, and to make sure that you fill out your meeting evaluations. And with that, Gary, would you read the motion to go into close?
I move that the Board of Education meet in closed session on Monday, December 14th, 2015, for the purpose of the evaluation of professional competency as provided by Iowa Code Section 21.51I.
Great, and is there a second?
Second.
This is a roll call.
Director Humbles?
Aye.
Director Jacobo?
Aye.
Director Meisterling?
Aye.
Director Anhalt?
Aye.
Director Jansen?
Aye.
Director Westerkamp?
Aye.
President Flaherty?
Aye. Thank you very much. The meeting is adjourned, and we'll go into a closed session.